So I went to New York from Mexico to find him, and I found him magically. Amazing situation.
These are what we in Leary's life call the Millbrook years, or
right.
It was before.
No, Millbrook. Right.
Millbrook, which was an estate in upstate New York, where they got together with.
Peggy, the Mellon family owned this old fantastic estate. It looked like a Dr. Frankenstein's castle. It was 3,000 acres, and because Leary at Harvard had helped the alcoholic problem of Billy Mellon Hitchcock, who was one of his students, with LSD and other things, the Mellon family was part of the Mellon family. Really started to back Leary, and so by backing him, they gave him this Millbrook Estate, which was a fantastic place. It was incredible. And so anyway, so that's where I found him, and that's where he was. He was up there. So I became friends with him and so on, and the purpose was to bring him back down to Mexico, which I did. I achieved that, along with Metzner, also. And so he went down to Mexico and so on. And
Metzner was one of his fellow researchers at Harvard into the use of psychedelics in those days of treating people with alcoholic problems and drug problems.
Yeah, exactly.
And they were hoping that in those days that LSD would be a tool for psychotherapeutic use.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. Ralph Metzner, who's still on the West Coast in California, Ralph Metzner was the actual workhorse of the three of them,
Richard Alpert, Dick Albert, now called Ram Dass.
Right, exactly. And Alpert was kind of the junior, Leary's kind of junior
researcher
attendee. But he had lots of problems, and it was, he was always causing, every time Leary would leave Millbrook, and come back, Alpert had turned it into this wild, gay, freak scene. So that always had to be straightened out. But in any case, so Leary was conducting his experiments and theoretical things and so on and so forth, and that's how I found him. So then I invited him to my studio in New York City on Avenue A and began to, make friends with him with the purpose of seeing what could be done later when we would put the human being together. So when that finally happened in 1967, I called him up and he came out from New York and he sat on the stage. And that's when he, along with others, and that's when he, like an artistic tableau of human beings that were known to people, other people. The Grateful Dead played, but we didn't allow their name to be on the poster at all because I didn't want people to come because there was a particular band playing or because of anything like that. Since only to come because to be, that's it. So that's
to be. Where was this happening? In San Francisco, where?
It happened in Golden Gate Parks in San Francisco. And
which is, if I compare that to, say, the Vondelpark in Amsterdam, is it comparable?
I don't think so. Golden Gate Park is a gigantic place. It goes from mid-San Francisco almost to the ocean. And it's really...
It's a little bit hilly too, huh?
Little bit, yeah. It's something very unusual. Really, it's an unusual place. So there was a place called the Polo Grounds, a polo field. I had no idea where to put this being on because we had no idea really how many people were going to come. So a friend of mine named Roberto Ayala, photographer, said, "Look, Bowen, you're too fat. I've got to run some of your fat off." So there's a place called the Polo Field. It's got a track. So we went out to the track. And, of course, the minute I saw the track, I realized, and the size of the place, I realized it would hold at least 25 to 30, 40,000 people if it had to. The next trick was how to let the city, which was extraordinarily hostile, exactly the opposite of what it is today, get a permit for the thing. And Cohen, Alan Cohen, tried and failed. And so he called me up and said, I don't know what I'm doing. It's not happening. I can get a permit for this thing. So anyway, so I went to a very famous lawyer friend of mine named Melvin Belli. And Belli said, look, he said, I'll just send down this woman who ran his office and and get you the permit. So that's what he did. So actually the human being was conducted on the permit of Melvin Belli's birthday party. It's for that reason there were no police. The only police that were there was like one cop that wandered in from the local police stables and was handed flowers and, you know, children and on his horse.
And when was this?
January 14th, 1967. But it was designed
now,
to be
people,
the first.
That's wintertime, but not in San Francisco, because January in San Francisco is what kind of weather?
January in San Francisco can be awful, can be horrible. So this place,
it
was absolutely fantastic, sun, perfect. So the date was picked by an astrologer who is also famous in psychic and astrological circles. His name was Gavin Arthur. And I had known him for years, so it was Gavin that picked the date. And the date was picked because, according to Gavin, that was the time on Earth when all the living were equal to all the past human dead, Homo sapiens. So that was the undercurrent, the background occult aspect, at least from there, that point of view. So Leary, we called Leary out in 1967, and he came out, and that's where he gave the turn on, tune in, drop out thing. And the reason for that was that the people on the stage, we didn't want to make speeches and harangue people. That was during the Berkeley political stuff when people were fighting the Vietnam War. And this was exactly the opposite from that. This was an attempt for human beings to realize what they already realized, that others, what they already realized in themselves, that others had realized that. And when you see all of these people like yourself together, suddenly this whole shock happens. As a result of that shock, positive shock, then came the love-ins and the, you know, every kind of copy of the human being until it ended 20,000, until it ended up with Woodstock.
Yeah, but how many people were there at the
20,000.
20,000? That's not what you expected.
No, we didn't know what to expect.
How did you promote it? I mean,
it was promoted by a poster that I made, another poster somebody else made. Nobody had any real money, so I think it was, we spent $500 to print the poster. That's why it's so rare. That's the one with the holy man from the Ganges coming up out of the water like this, and there's a triangle. That's my poster. And then there was another one. And so that poster went up around the city, and there was some flyers. But everybody was already so close during this strange six-month period in Haight-Ashbury that, I mean...
That already happened before that?
Well, it was just happening. It was just happening. And the being coalesced that and brought in others. And then, of course, it degenerated later, but that didn't matter because that's a natural cycle. So for 6 months, and 2 months prior to the being, you had this kind of openness between people. Houses were open to each other. People worked with each other without concern. And it was truly an experience.
It was a few blocks in San Francisco.
Very few.
Called the Haight-Ashbury, where
right.
This happened, where this energy. Now, how much of that was related to the use of psychedelic drugs like LSD?
I think a lot of it was. A lot of it.